Yeah, Heavenly Father, we just want to give you praise and give you glory this morning. We thank you, Father, that this morning we have breath in our lungs, that we have life in our body. But not only in our body, Lord, but we have life in our soul, because your Holy Spirit has awakened us. Lord, we pray today, God, would you come and visit us afresh? Would you fill us with your Holy Spirit? Would you come and convict us and encourage us through your word? And Father, most of all, Lord, we pray that you encourage us and refresh us through fellowship and community with one another together as we are the body of Christ, the church. May we encounter Christ this morning, Lord, we pray, from the body of Christ, the church, one another. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name.
It says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. Hallelujah. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you, God, are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." We say amen. What an amazing promise from our Lord God.
so good. One thing I do want to declare to you this morning is that if you raise your hallelujah to Jesus Christ, you'll restore and refresh your soul. That's what we're here for this morning. We're here to take our eyes off of things and stuff, and we're here to place our focus on the great I Am, Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Of your name, King of Majesty, there is no one.
Good to have you in the house this morning, Pastor. So this is the God that we serve, amen. I just pray that that encourages you this morning. Okay, so let's press on. I want to press on this morning in our exploration of the Godward heart. Because the heart really matters to God, doesn't it? Your heart really matters to God. He's not bothered about how well your life looks on the outside. God is concerned with how your heart looks. That is the message of Jesus Christ. The heart is the most important thing in your life. It's the most essential thing that you have been given responsibility over. Yeah, we're responsible for the holiness of our nation, amen, for the holiness of our city and our culture, and we're responsible for that as ambassadors and priests of God. But first and foremostly, we're responsible for our hearts. It's for this reason that the scripture says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. One translation says, the issues of life flow from your heart. Therefore, guard it with all diligence. You see, the heart, your heart, actually sets the direction of your life. It defines the course of your life. If you are committed to holiness, if you are committed to becoming more like Jesus Christ, then I can promise you today that you will go exactly where God needs you to go. It's not so much trying to work out the will of God, trying to work out, is it this I'm supposed to do, or is it this I'm supposed to do? I want to tell you today that if your heart, your main goal, your ambition is to live this word out and be conformed into it and live according to it and abide by it and become holy as Christ himself is holy, I want to tell you that you won't miss the will of God. You'll be bang, straight, smack bang in the middle of it. This is why we need the God with heart, guys. Because it's the God that we're pursuing. The God with heart is a heart that is Godward. It's not hell-bound, but it's heaven-destined. It's pursuing the things of God. This is what it means to have a heart after God's own heart. And so our exploration this week brings us to Psalm 23. If you'd like to turn there with me this morning, Psalm 23. This is a very famous piece of scripture written by David, the King David. We don't actually know if he was king or if it was before he was king, but these are just fantastic words that I'm sure many of us will know. Psalm 23, we're going to read the whole chapter. Hear now the word of the living and the true God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Here we have one of the most, if not the most, famous psalms within the whole scripture. But before we go any further, I think one question really does need to be asked. What is a psalm? I'm not asking the question of what is a psalm. We're not talking about reading the psalms here. We're talking about reading the psalms. You see, I say that because when I first became a Christian, when I was still trying to break free from drugs and I was living next door to the crack house, I can remember one time, I think I've told you this story before, but I went into the crack house and I was smoked a crack pipe. I had a crack pipe in there. I spent hundreds of pounds on crack cocaine. And I was there testifying about what Jesus Christ had done in my life, about the encounter that I'd had with him before. You see, at this moment, I was going through a bit of a tricky time, and you know, I'd not been to rehab yet, and all that sort of stuff. I had a bad time. I was in this crack house, I was talking all about Jesus. And do you know what they said to me? Stephen, you're back, you mad. How can you tell us about God when you're sat there with a crack pipe in your hand? And then the next day, this lady comes out of the crack house. I'm there, I'm sorry, I've repented. I'm like, well, I need to just start following Jesus again. And I do. I last about another 6 weeks. That's another story. And she comes out to me and she goes, oh, Stephen, you know, I've really been thinking about what you said last night, and I've been reading the Psalms. And that's what they're called, isn't it? The Psalms. And she started citing a bit of scripture she'd read. Now, I find that funny, because we're not here reading the Psalms, we're here reading the Psalms. I mean, she didn't know this, she might have known it, maybe the Spirit in her knew it, but reading the Psalms is actually of the occult. It's actually of the mystics and the witchcraft and all that sort of stuff. We're not here to read Psalms, we're here to read the Psalms. So, what is a Psalm? Well, a Psalm is quite simply a prayer or a prophecy written down and expressed through a poem or a song. Psalms are written in response to lived experiences and circumstances. I mean, you can find a lot of encouragement in the Psalms. Sometimes people really experience brokenness, really difficult circumstances, and then they prayed and cried out to God, and they recorded it in the psalm form for us. Psalms were also hymns. They were songs. They were also written in response to revelations from God. And so we often do find that psalms are very prophetic. There's so much prophecies about the kingdom of Christ and the future of world history found here in the psalms. Think about all the times the nations are referred to. I really would encourage you to read that, because if you're like just fed up with what's going on in society, I'm telling you now, this word has a different report on where history is heading. But what we have is revelations from God in Psalms. We have prophecies in Psalms. And that is what I believe that we have here in Psalm 23. You see, this psalm takes place in two imaginary places. It takes place in the imaginary setting of the outside world in which we live and dwell. But it also takes place in the inner soul, in the inward being. And that is really, really fitting, because we're talking about the Godward heart today. So it's going to communicate something to us about what it means to have a heart that is after God's own heart. According to scholars, this is a sign of confidence. It expresses God's care and goodness as the great and good shepherd, but it also expresses God's care and goodness as the host, which is what the final two verses refer to. It's a psalm of confidence, very much, because it's a psalm about contentment. It's a psalm about being content. I want to say to you today that the Godward heart is a content heart. It's a heart that is content in any circumstance. It's a heart that finds contentment, not in money, not in how big your business is, how big your church is, how big the career, how high the career ladder you've gone, how many children you've had. It's a heart that's content, not in success defined in the terms of a lost world or a Western individualistic society. No. The Godward heart is a heart that finds its contentment not in circumstances, but in God alone. That is the Godward heart I want to say to you today. I mean, this is clear from what's written in today's passage by King David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I just love that. The Lord is my number one, I shall not want any other thing but God alone. The Lord is my all. In Him is everything that I need. The Lord is my parent. He's my carer. He's my provider. He's my shepherd. He provides my every need. Notice that. I'm not saying He provides my every want. He doesn't give me everything I want. He's not some sugar daddy in heaven who just gives me everything I need and spoils me. Well, He does spoil us, doesn't He? He's a good God. Salvation's great. It's amazing. It's remarkable, the inheritance we have. But on this earth, sometimes people say, why don't God just get rid of all my problems? Why don't God answer this prayer that I've been praying about? Well, you know, quite often the answer is God gives us what we need and not what we want. And in His infinite wisdom, He knows more of what we need than we often do. So the Godward heart is a content heart. Amen? But this is also clear when we look at David's life as well as we look at the psalm. Last week I mentioned that King David spent most of his adult life, before he was king, on the run from King Saul. I mean, I want you to think about that for one moment. 50% of the psalms are written by David. We know that. And probably many of them were written during this time period when he was on the run from King Saul. I mean, let's look at David's life just for a second. The prophet Samuel anoints David to be king of Israel when David is just a small boy. Yet that promise for him to be king in his life doesn't come to pass for decades. He had to wait so long for that promise of being king to come to pass in his life. And yet we know that he was a content man when we read the Psalms. We know that even for all those difficulties, King Saul trying to hunt him down and being on the run, he was a very, very content man. He wasn't looking to elevate himself. He wasn't looking to make himself king or make things happen and manipulate circumstances. But he was simply patient. He learned to be patient. And more importantly, he learned to be content with where he was at in that moment in life. He learned to trust God. You know, after Samuel had anointed David, David doesn't really change what he's doing. He just carries on shepherding the sheep. He wasn't looking for a promotion, but the promotions, well, they came to him. You see, David was sent for as a young boy to play music for Saul in the king's court shortly after he was anointed king. God positioned David, not by David's orchestrating, but by the sovereign Almighty God who guides Israel in his hand. He was the one who positioned David into the king's court who would play music and serve the king. He was happy during this time, David, to go to and fro from the king's court, playing for the king and tending the sheep back at home. He was a servant. He had a servant heart. And when David finally became king, they sent for him. He didn't force his way in. They came to him and said, "The king is dead. Now you will come into your kingdom." I want you to catch that. David became king in God's timing, not in his. Because he had learned to be content in all situations and circumstances, even the hardest. He wasn't ambitious. He wasn't looking for breakthrough. Nor did he seek to establish himself on the throne. But he was content in every situation because he trusted God with the outcome of his life. To put it short, he was content in Christ and Christ alone. If David were to have nothing, which at times he did, I'm reminded just now about that passage where he's, you know, foaming and stuff and pretending that he's got something wrong with him. In that very moment there, does that say he wouldn't get caught, basically, in common territory? But in that moment there, he has nothing but the clothes he's wearing. But yet he learned to be content as long as he had Jesus Christ. That was his number one thing. And so I want to ask you today, Restoration Church, can you say that about your own heart this morning? Does that describe your heart? Because it's the condition of your heart that God cares about. He's not bothered about you pretending to be content before the Christians, or pretending to be content just in general, but really struggling with it in your heart. God cares about the condition of your heart. He sees straight through your flesh, straight through your body, and he gazes right into your heart, into your inmost being, thoughts. And God wants us to have a content heart. I want to ask you today, does this description of the heart that is after God's own heart describe your heart today? If you lost everything, just think of this for a second with me. If you lost everything tomorrow, if you lost your job, your house, maybe your wife or your husband, God forbid, if you lost your son or your daughter or something, would you still be able to say, "I am content because I have Jesus Christ"? Would you be able to sing the hymn, "Hallelujah, all I have is Christ"? Would you be able to sing that with a full and honest heart? I want to say to you, that is the heart of surrender that God is looking for. It was learning to be content in all situations that prepared David to be the great king that he was. And in Psalm 23, he gives us a spiritual blueprint of how we too can be content and cultivate the heart of contentment in all situations. In verse 1, he says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." I want to say to you today that this is the first step to contentment. The first step is to make Christ your shepherd and your Lord. I say that because in the ancient times, the shepherd and the Lord were synonymous. They were one and the same thing, really. I mean, kings were often referred to as shepherds. You can find that theme all the way through the Bible. And what did shepherds do? What do lords do? Well, they provide leadership to their people. They provide protection and provision. And just as a shepherd cares for his sheep, so the Lord cares for his people. He cares for his church. He guides us, he protects us, and he provides everything that we need. I want to assure you today that if you truly make Christ your Lord, many of us have got him as our Savior, but we don't really have him as our Lord. Every area of our lives is not, you know, Godward. We're not obeying him in every area of our lives. I want to assure you today that if you make Christ your Lord, you will not lack any good thing. That means that we obey the commands of Scripture. That means that we obey what the Word of God says for our lives, and we live it out, and we follow Christ as Lord. He will be faithful to us. We'll not lack anything we need. So David goes on. He says that the Lord makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. The second step to contentment is to know and enjoy the Good Shepherd's gracious provisions. If we take a turn from God, turn from what God has provided us to other things, well, we're never going to be content. I mean, we can see that when we just look out into the city of Oxford. People are chasing this, they're chasing that, they're chasing everything. They're looking for that contentment that can only be found in Jesus Christ. And what David is saying here is that green pastures and still waters are peaceful places of rest and feeding for the son or daughter of God. You see, Christ provides spiritual food and spiritual drink. The spiritual food being the Word of God. Jesus Christ himself said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." You know, if we want to be content, guys, if we want to cultivate this Godward heart of contentment, we need to be regular feeding on the Scriptures. We need to be meditating on the Word of God. We need to be reading our Bibles every day. Not because it's a religious act and we want to please God, because, you know what, God, it doesn't bother God if you read your Bible or not, but it does bother you. You know, you're not going to know that assurance in your heart. You're not going to have peace in your heart. You're not going to have the contentment that we're speaking about here, because you're out of the will of God. If you're not reading the Word of God, how can you be in the will of God if you're not even coming to the Word of God? If you're not hearing what the Word of God says to you? Instead of filling our minds with TV, with Netflix, with newspapers and Facebook and Instagram and YouTube, we need to be feeding upon the Word of God. I want to challenge you today, church. How much time are you in on the internet, and how much time are you in the Word of God? Jesus Christ also provides us with spiritual drink. He said that if anyone thirsts, let him come to me, and he who believes in me, as Scripture has said, out of his inmost being will flow rivers of living water. Sometimes when I quote that, I often say livers of living water. We don't want livers coming out, do we, of our stomachs? But no, rivers of living water. What is this drink that he's talking about? He's talking about the Holy Spirit, the promise of God of the Holy Spirit upon those who believe. You know, we often try to quench our thirst by going to these polluted and broken fountains in the world whether it be drinking, whether it be pleasures. I took drugs for years because I wanted the drink, that peace, that restoration, that spiritual energy that only the Holy Spirit could give me. And I never ever found it. I was always left thirsty. But I want to tell you today that if you will seek the Holy Spirit with all your heart, He will fill you. He will fill you, and you will just, you won't want anything else. You know, the hymn writer said that gaze, is it? What's that hymn? Look full in His wonderful grace, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim. Light of His glory and grace. I want to tell you today, are you seeking the Holy Spirit? Are you seeking God? Do you want to be baptized and filled and endued with power from on high with the Holy Ghost? It's not going to happen if you're just going to be sat there watching Netflix. We need to be on our knees. We need to get to knee pads and get learning how to cry out to God. Amen? We need to be seeking. Sorry if this is a challenging message today. I'm simply just saying what God's told me to say. The reality is that a sheep can never be content if it is thirsty. We need the living water. We need the Holy Spirit. We need the anointing, not just to preach or to lead worship, but we need the anointing so that we can live the life that God intended us to live. Okay, I'm going to press on. Christ provides us with spiritual restoration and spiritual guidance. David continues. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. You see, God restores and refreshes us, as I've just demonstrated through the Word of God and through the washing and refreshing of the Spirit of God. I don't really want to go much more into that, but He does. He restores us as we conform our lives to His image. He brings back His holiness, His life, and it's that which is the shield in life. It protects us from the dangers that sin causes. Amen. And He refreshes us. He gives us peace. He gives us assurance of salvation. No more anxiety. No more fear. No more stress. Because we're living happy and blessed. With me in my Saviour, I am at rest. Hallelujah. That's the promise of God. And how does He do this? Well, He does it through leading us in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. He leads us in that holy life. And it's when we're living that holy life, when we're living according to this word, this blueprint, if we're, you know, no longer lusting after men or women, and we're no longer living in sin, then it's then that we begin to find ourselves. I would say, like, in my own experience, it's almost like I feel like the Holy Spirit is taking control of my life. When I start offering my life over to God in every area, when I start surrendering everything, it's almost like there's another power that's at control. And I find myself walking in the stream, in the will of God. And it's an incredible feeling to know. Having this perfect peace, this perfect assurance. Doors opening, God speaking. This is all available to us today, but we need to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. That's what that scripture means. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you might know the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. It's about the word. Read, meditated upon, and lived out in the power of the Spirit. And it's then that all of you guys in here are going to receive revelation, and you're going to know God's will for your life. And I'm telling you something, it's exciting. It's exciting. And we want to be here every step to support you in that. Okay, the third step of contentment is to walk with Christ through hard times. David says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. The King James says that. Runneth over. My cup overflows. I want to tell you today, guys, that we need to be walking closely with God through the difficult times, through the times of fear, and anxiety. I feel like someone needs to hear that today. When fear and anxiety come upon you, that's the time to draw even closer to God than ever. You know, Richard Sibbes, this is one of my life quotes, I quote this all the time. He said that our extremity is God's opportunity. He was a Puritan a few hundred years ago, fantastic theologian. That's what he said. Our extremity, our difficult circumstances are God's opportunity to work and glorify himself. I want to tell you today, when you're feeling scared, when you're anxious about life or situations, that's the time to get on your knees and come to the cross. Because you know what? Something's going to die in you through that fear, but also something's going to be birthed. And that's the resurrecting power of Jesus Christ. You know, during the times when we're walking through the shadow of death, through the fear and the anxiety, this is the time to draw near to God. We need to be walking close with Christ in the times of conflict. For he prepared a table for us in the presence of my enemies. Do you know when your enemies are drawing near? When there's conflict? When you feel like you're surrounded by people who are opposing you and not on your side? I want to tell you that this is a time to draw close to God, because he's got a blessing for you. He's got a feast prepared for you. I mean, if we got this, this would be incredible. It changes our whole outlook on life. We'd start seeing all these bad things and things that we have to go through daily as times when we can really receive something from God here. God can switch this bad into good. What the enemy meant for evil, God meant for good. Amen. It's all there. It's written in the Word of God. Okay, so the fourth and final step to contentment is to see God's goodness in every situation, both now and future. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I want to tell you that this is the most essential secret to cultivating a content heart. David said, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Surely goodness and mercy, surely Christ is with me now, and I have him, and he is the greatest gift and prize that can ever be found on the face of the earth. That should fill you with joy, excitement. Man, I am the most blessed person in the world. Not because I've got a nice car, or a nice house, or because I've got a baby shower, which is pretty amazing. But I'm the most blessed man because I have Jesus Christ. Blessed man, because for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Hallelujah. That's what Paul said. To live is Christ. This life right now, to live is Christ. To experience him, to know him. But when I die, guess what, guys? It gets even better. I'm directly into his presence. I don't have to fear anymore dying. In fact, when I die, that's the biggest blessing. I receive my reward. I receive a crown of eternal life. Man, this should make us the most happy people on the planet. We're living in a culture that loves death. They want to bring in assisted suicide. They want to abort children. They want to cause people's sexuality and gender to be messed up. They want to just destroy things around us. But we have a message of life and hope. That the grave has lost its sting, amen? That there's never going to be no more sin, that God's going to restore this planet. And for us individually today, to live is Christ and die is gain. You know, when it's this verse here that calls for missions, people to go over to China and Africa and lose their lives. Was it Africa, Pastor Dennis, where they actually carried the coffins with them? They went on a mission trip. I think it was the early Pentecostals who did that. I can't remember. But they actually carried coffins with them. They were prepared to die as soon as they set foot because they knew that they had something better waiting. They were waiting for a city whose maker and founder is God. I want to say to you today, guys, if we're going to be truly content in him, regardless of our circumstances or what's happening in our lives, then God needs to purge us of our love for the things of this world. And that is the biggest one. I really believe that with COVID, in the lockdown, and the secularism and just the hostility of everything right now against biblical Christianity. You know, some people are like, oh, but where's God in this? You know, good God won't let this happen to his church. Let this happen to the world. Well, I want to tell you, the will of God is that he will purge us of our love for the things in this world, that he purges of our comforts, of our securities, and that we would learn to just trust in Christ and Christ alone. Because you know what? It's then when we're the most rich. When we are poorest and when we are dependent upon him in our weakness, that's when we are the strongest, that's when we are the richest, and that is when we are most glorified in Jesus Christ and his glory. The writer of the Hebrews writes in Hebrews 13, verse 5, keep your life free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I want to say to you that the Godward heart is a content heart. You know, to close, I close with one more verse of scripture. Summed up, this was wonderfully summed up, this content heart, in the words of the Apostle Paul, which often do make me cry, these words, because they're just so powerful. But he summed it up this way. From a prison cell, he writes this. I have learned in whatever situation to be content. I know how to be brought low. I know how to abound, be brought high. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and facing hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. In other words, I've learned to master every situation through being content in him who is my all in all, Jesus Christ, my Lord and Saviour. Amen. I was just wondering now if you could just get Pastor Dennis to come up and pray for us. And I was wondering, would you also be able to lead us in the communion, please?
Sure.
This morning, if you would mind. Thank you very much, Pastor. Praise God.
Would you mind coming up and playing a moment? Thank you. Thank you, my brother. I have preached here many times in the old days, well, the old days before Stephen. And this is amazing what he's accomplished here. And I remember being in the congregation that was before and witnessing the candle going out. But now, it's lit again. This is the temple of God. And the fire that's kept alive is the presence of God. His glory is here. His presence is here. The shepherd is here. He wants to minister to you. You know, the shepherd would take care of the sheep. If they would get ticks, then he would anoint their heads. If they fell over, you know, that was called being cast. You know, my soul is cast down. And if they stayed like that too long, they would bloat and they would die. You know, that the shepherd would keep their wool clean, you know, from all the filth in the world. And that shepherd is here today. His name is Jesus, and he cares about you. He's here to strengthen you. He's here to take care of whatever is eating you, what's ever coming against you, to protect you. So I just want to ask you to stand in the presence of Jesus, your shepherd. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, allow him to anoint you with oil. Whatever is eating you, whatever is biting at you right now, receive comfort from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet. He is the Lord who restores your soul. He restores your soul. He lifts you up when you fall down. He heals you. He brings life into you. Anyone thirsty? Is there anyone thirsty? Come to me. Come. been hitting the life that has inhibited you, nothing's going to hold you back. And if you have a heart that wants to wander, today be healed from that. Your heart, that wandering heart, in Jesus' name, in your heart of hearts, tell Him, I will never leave you. I will stay with you, my shepherd, all the days of my life. I will stay with you, no matter how hard it gets. And I will be content, not because you've given me everything, just because you are my shepherd. You're my shepherd. I shall not want, because you are my shepherd. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Release. 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 Comfort. Restoration. Thank you, Father. Come, Holy Spirit. You are welcome in this place. This is your home, Holy Spirit. This is for you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I pray every Sunday when people walk in that door, they'll know God is here. Thank you, Lord. He was here before you got here. This is holy ground. Holy ground. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just stand in His presence for a moment. And if you know how to pray in the Spirit, do that. If you've never done that before, just release whatever is in you. Just stand in His presence. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Good.
been there, our hearts saying, dear God, I'm sorry that I wander from you. I wander from you at times. I don't stay as close to you as I should. But Jesus wants you to know something. No matter how far you wander, he will come to get you. And he will bring you back in. He'll put you on his shoulders. And he'll bring you back. Hallelujah. Because he's the good shepherd. He lays down his life for the sheep. Glory to his holy name. The Lord is my shepherd. Will you say that with me? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want.
Yeah, that's okay.
Bless now, give our offerings to God with a generous heart. time. It's a good thing to do. It's a good way that we can put this message today into practice. You know, we can be content when we give to God, when we follow what His Word tells us to do. And do you know what? The greatest way to be content in life is to help someone else. Be generous. Give your life away so that others can find Jesus Christ. Okay, thank you for being with us this morning. This ends the formal part of our gathering. We're going to go in there now and have a coffee. We'd love to fellowship with you some more. Do you know what? I just think it's amazing. Like, did you know, guys, that this church was going to be called Green Pastures? Mm-hmm. We've been talking about Green Pastures today, haven't we? It was going to be called Green Pastures, but the national leadership didn't think it was, it wasn't very seeker-friendly. But you know, we thank God for the national leadership team, because I believe the name that we have as Restoration Church is God's plan and purpose. Father God, we want to thank you this morning, Lord, for your presence, for your faithfulness to us, for your kindness, for your generosity. We thank you, Lord, so much, Lord, that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die in our place, to take the wrath of God on our part, to take the punishment that we deserve, Lord, so that we could go free. And do you know what, Lord? That is incredible that you value us that much, that you would send your only Son to die for us. Lord, may that minister to us today, Lord, of how much we are worth to you. Father, we pray in Jesus' name, would you help us to live out what we've heard this morning? Would you help us to follow the Good Shepherd into every area of our lives in our weeks? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.